How are you, boys and girls? Today we'll be looking at the properties of webs. And just before that, I'll to show you this is a sling screen. This is an example of exhibits both what you call the longitudinal web and transverse web. Of course, we know that there are only two types of webs, what you call the transverse web. Then we have what you call the longitudinal web. So these are the only types of web that of course we're talking about. But of course, when you look at this, this one exhibits both the longitudinal web and transverse web. As you can see from there, and now you see when you talk about transverse web, it actually exhibits the following nature of the graph, as in this one here, we have this part, then of course we can see that this is what we have. This one here is the one we talk about, the transverse web, But of course, when you talk about the longitudinal web, you are likely to see these ones here. I'm going to explain them. These ones here, this one is what you call longitudinal webs. These are longitudinal webs. These ones here are the ones we are talking about. Now you can see that when you talk about the transverse web, one, this is a transverse web. You can see that this part here we call the crest. This is the crest, and this down part here we call it the trough. The trough. And of course, we know that we can actually determine the wavelength from there to there. This part, the distance from crest to another crest is what you call the wavelength. The distance between one crest to another, or it could be one trough to another, this one here is what you call the wavelength. At the same time, when you talk about the longitudinal web, we are saying that we have what you call the compression, we have what you call the rear function. We have compression, the rear function of the compression, the rear function. So you can see that for us to find what you call wavelength, we can say that go to the center of a compression, go to the center of another compression, then from there we are actually have this distance there. That distance is the what we call the wavelength. Now we are saying that the distance between the center of one wavelength, I mean of one compression, with the center of another wavelength, of another compression, that is where we are going to have what you call our wavelength. And you can see that this one, we're talking about the longitudinal wave. This is exactly what I'm talking about. You can see from the other side, from your screen, that when I do this, there's a compression, then the rear function. This time it exhibits what I'm talking about. So we have what you call compressions and the rear function right from here. And of course, when you see a wave coming like this, perpendicular to the motion, perpendicular to the direction of the wave motion, that one there is what you call the transverse wave. Now we can proceed. Now we have what you call wavelength, which I've been explaining just using this. You can see from there the wavelength, the distance between one wave peak and the next wave peak along the path of a wave. Wavelength is measured in meter. In the other one, we are saying the wavelength is actually the distance. The distance between two successive peaks, two successive crests, or two successive troughs. That's why I was saying that it could be crest, it could be trough. It could be for that is for the transverse. It could be for longitudinal web, compression. We don't use rear function because it will be difficult for you to determine the center of actually a rear function. But of course, when you're having compression, it will be very easy for us to find that. That's why you can see from here that the wavelength, the distance between one wave peak to the next wave peak along the path of the wave. Wavelength measured in meters. You can see this is a crest, this is another crest, so that now we are saying actually this is the wavelength. Actually, you can say also you have the trough, Of course, you can say this also is actually a wavelength. Wavelength is also the distance between bottom of one trough to another, which I've just explained in detail. Now, there is what you call the frequency. Frequency is the number of waves peak that pass a point in 1 second. Very true. For example, if I do this, like this, then I have a complete wave. I have, let's say, 10 complete waves passing through a point within 1 second. Right? Complete waves. Complete, they have to be complete wave peaks that pass within a point within 1 second. So we are saying that those, the number of waves passing through upon in 1 second. That is what you call the frequency. And of course, frequency is measured in what you call hertz. What you call hertz. So you're saying that one hertz is actually 1 peak per second, and two peaks per second, and so on. And we are saying that there is another unit for frequency, where we are saying that if there are 1,000 hertz, we can actually say it is 1 kilohertz. If it's 1 million hertz, we can say that one is 1 mega. But in time, we are saying that if you go up and down several within 1 second, let's say you make it 10 times, within 1 second, we say the frequency of that particular wave is actually 10 hertz. Very clear. Don't confuse that one with what you call the periodic, which I'm going to explain right here. We have what you call the time period, capital T. Capital T, the time period is the time taken for a soul of produced one wave. When you look at this, I'm going to explain, and we are going to see the relation between what you call the frequency and what you call the time period. Now you see that time period, the time taken for a source to produce one wave. We are saying that time period, which is T, is actually one of our frequency. And of course, we are saying that this, if you talk about the time taken for a source to produce one wave, right? A source to produce one wave. What does it mean? We can now change it because you know that frequency is going to be 1 second. The number of waves per second. That's why you're saying that period and frequency are related. But the only relation is the reciprocal of the other. That's why you're saying that time, T is equal to 1 over frequency, and of course F is equal to 1 over T. So that now we are saying that we can write T 1 over F, and of course we can say F is actually 1 over T, which are actually related. That's why we are saying that from here, you can say that time period is equal to 1 over frequency, which is 1 over F, and frequency is 1 over time period, which is F is equal to 1 over T. Now, of course, there are so many calculations which actually will be using frequency, will be using time period, or what you call the periodic time. Now, for example, here, calculate the frequency of a wave of time period 8 seconds. I want you to try fast. I want you to try fast just before you proceed. Calculate the frequency of a wave time period is 8 seconds. Of 8 seconds. You can see from there that you have been given time is actually 8 seconds. And of course we need a frequency. We know that frequency is 1 over T. We need to put the formula first. 1 over T, which means actually 1 over 8. This one is actually 0.0. 1 over 8 will be 0.125. And remember, frequency, we are talking about what? We are talking about hertz. So that will be the value, 0.125 from there, 125 hertz. So that now we are saying that this one is 1 over T, which is 1 over 8, so frequency is equal to 0.125. Next one is calculate the time period for a wave of frequency 50 hertz. How did you time? Just then, calculate the time period of a wave of frequency 50 hertz. Calculate the time period. Calculate the time period of a wave of frequency 50 hertz. Of course, you can see that T is equal to 1 over F, which means that one is going to be 1 over 50, which means it's going to be 0.02. And of course, we are talking about time, so it's going to be what? It's going to be second. Very clear. Calculate the time period of a wave of frequency. You must be having a calculator somewhere for you to calculate this. So calculate the time period of a wave, so that stays 1 over F, so it will be 1 over 50, and the time period is actually 0.02 second. Now, just before you go to the wave equation, I want to emphasize on this, that T is equal to 1 over F, and F is actually 1 over 2. Once you know that the two equations, the frequency and the time are related, it will be very easy for you to move to the next part. I think from our next part of our lesson, we are going to discuss about wave equations. Thank you.